Good morning.
Welcome to the Presbyterian Church. You should be welcoming me, I guess, but I welcome you. And my name is Deborah Given. I'm a retired pastor, a member of this presbytery. I served in Leonia for 15 years before retiring, and I was also a friend of your former pastor, Frank Eason, and now also Timothy's son. I'm happy to know both of them. I welcome the people who are worshiping from home, and I thank you all for coming out on this sweltering day. I hope that you made it here safely, and I'm so glad that there's air conditioning here. Let us join together our hearts and worship God. Please stand if you're able for the call to worship. Give ear to my words, O God. Give heed to my groaning. Hearken to the sound of my cry, for to you I pray.
I enter your house and worship you, O God. Lead me in righteousness and make straight your way.
Let us worship God. Our first hymn is number 15, All Creatures of Our God and King.
Jesus is always with you and will help you when you are afraid or tempted to do something is not right. Since there are so many wonderful things about knowing and loving Jesus, those who tell other people about Jesus have a very important job to do. The last instruction that Jesus gave to the disciples before he went back to heaven was to go and tell everyone about Jesus. So Jesus told them to tell everyone, not only those people in Jerusalem, but all nations. This command was not only for the disciples long, long time ago. It is for us today too. So Jesus told us we should tell the whole world about Jesus. The whole world, it's a lot of people. So let's start with those people who we see every day, like our friends, people we see at school, or people who live in our neighborhood. I know, sometimes it can be scary to tell others about Jesus, or it may seem like too hard for us. But please remember this, Jesus promises to always be with us and help us. And we know, Jesus always keeps his promises. So don't be afraid to tell others about Jesus. Let us pray. I invite you all to pray with me. Dear God, thank you for your promise. And help us as we tell the whole world about Jesus.
Help us as we tell the whole world about Jesus.
In Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Let's join together the prayer for illumination. Lead us in this moment of proclamation, God.
Enlighten us with your spirit. Motivate us with your word. Remind us of your commands. Challenge us to live in your way. Hold us accountable to do more than sing and pray.
In Christ, amen. Our scripture this morning is from Luke and then from Romans. And he said to them, suppose one of you has a friend, and you go to him at midnight and say to him, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived, and I have nothing to set before him. And he answers from within, do not bother me. The door has already been locked, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up and give you anything. I tell you, even though he will not get up and give him anything, because he is a friend, at least because of his persistence, he will get up and give him whatever he needs. So I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Search, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who searches finds, and for everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Is there anyone among you who, if your child asks for a fish, will give a snake instead of a fish? Or if the child asks for an egg, will give a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? From Romans. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. The word of the Lord.
Be to God.
Be to God.
I am the rock of ages.
Doug said we were digging at the bottom of the barrel.
I was in that barrel.
You were in the barrel,
yeah.
Okay. Please join me again in prayer. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Has anyone ever told you, I'm spiritual but not religious? Anyone ever hear that? What does that even mean? Since you're here today on a scorching hot Sunday, I assume you're religious. And those of you who are watching from home, if you're still tuning in after these many years of the pandemic, you must be religious too. Do you think of yourself also as spiritual? If so, what do the two have to do with each other? A while ago, I was asked to be part of an interfaith panel discussing the question, what is spirituality? I joined a Jewish rabbi, a Muslim imam, and a yoga teacher. And no, we did not walk into a bar. The event was held at a retirement community in Teaneck. Very few people came to hear our words of wisdom. But it was an interesting topic to me, and I wanted to hear what the others had to say. So I agreed to participate. As I was preparing, I thought about the relationship between religion and spirituality. As I see it, spirituality is longing for communion with God, the source of all being. It's an experience of the divine, something larger than ourselves or holy. And most people have had some kind of religious or, spiritual experience at least once in their lives. Some people have them on a regular basis. I'm not one of them, but I do cherish the times when I feel a real connection with God, sometimes singing in church, walking in nature, talking with other people, or praying to God. Religion, on the other hand, is something different. It's a way of life, a system of rituals, beliefs, traditions, morals, and goals. It's the framework for understanding spiritual experience. Now, there are important differences between the different religions and how they shape our lives, but every religion is based in some kind of spiritual experience. On the panel, the yoga teacher spoke about the experience of feeling connected to one's own body and soul and the spirit of the universe. The imam spoke about a life of prayer aimed at purifying the soul. The rabbi talked about recapturing that sense of awe the Hebrew people felt in Old Testament times. The actual spiritual experiences may be similar from religion to religion, but each religion makes sense of them in different ways. Whatever religion we practice, spirituality gives life and energy to it. And any time a religion drifts from spiritual experience, it starts to die and becomes just another institution, a club of like-minded people, good-intentioned people who have little to offer the world beyond good deeds and a set of rules. Of course, we need good deeds and rules, but that's not what motivates and inspires faith. Jesus came at a time when the Jewish religion had been cut off from its spiritual roots. There had been no prophets for hundreds of years, and for many people, religion was reduced to burdensome rules and regulations, lacking in joy. Jesus brought a message of the Spirit. He proclaimed, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near." He also said the kingdom of God is within you or among you. It's here now for you to experience. And Jesus brought that message to all the people, not just the super religious, but also to people outside of religion. of Judaism in the time of Christ, Christianity also goes through periods where it is cut off from its spiritual roots and loses energy and power. When that happens, eventually a revival comes along, a reformation, and the Spirit breaks through in new ways to people again. We may be going through one of those periods now. Many Presbyterian churches these days are dying a slow death of attrition, with members getting older and no new or younger people joining in. It's happening all over the country, in all mainline denominations, and even in some of the more evangelical ones. Our culture is drifting away from organized religion, even while people are still longing to feel a connection with God and with other people. Does the Christian faith still offer any kind of help? I was raised in a Presbyterian church in the 1960s. As a child, I had no interest in religion and never looked forward to going to Sunday school. It was just something boring we had to endure. And as a young teenager, I didn't hear much in the sermons or see much in my parents' lives to believe that there was anything real or relevant in what was going on in church. The people in church were all good people, but to me, it seemed like a social club. The adults got together to have picnics or play bridge, and occasionally they did a good deed, but it didn't seem much worth pursuing in it. But then I discovered a charismatic house church where people spoke in tongues, sung like they meant it, spoke openly about their needs and problems, and prayed with passion to God and for each other. I was swept up in the spirit of worship and came alive inside. Suddenly, I couldn't get enough Bible reading and prayer. My parents were worried that I was becoming too religious, but I was attracted to the spirituality, the passion and deep thirst for God in that group. And it was also a great way to rebel against my parents and their ho-hum attitude toward religion. I graduated from high school and then went to a Quaker college, where I learned to sit in silence and meditate during a silent meeting for worship, a new form of spirituality for me. I also attended morning prayer at a nearby Episcopal church, where they had a set liturgy that could be memorized and then prayed from the heart. We Presbyterians are not known for our spiritual traditions. We tend to be more intellectual about our faith. Many of us are more comfortable talking about God than talking to God or listening to God. I had to go outside of Presbyterianism to experience God, but eventually I returned to the Presbyterian Church. While charismatic worship is fine for a while, but Presbyterians have an organization and structure which is needed. Quaker silence is a helpful discipline, and I still meditate at times, but I missed the singing and joy in worship. I still use the Episcopal prayer book for daily worship at home, but Presbyterians allow for more spontaneity in worship. We Presbyterians aren't perfect, but no denomination is. Perhaps we can learn from each other how to cultivate a deeper sense of spirituality in our lives and in our churches. Kathy read from the Apostle Paul this morning, "The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought." We all go through times of weakness. Even Paul did. He complained of having a thorn in his flesh. We are weakened by stress and anxiety, by violence, depression, poverty, disease, mental illness. We are weakened by our own foolish choices. And if everything is going well for us, we can be weakened by complacency, dulled by indifference, and sometimes we're simply ignorant. None of us really knows how. how to pray. Paul adds, we don't know how to pray, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. No one needs eloquent words to pray. We can just open our hearts and follow the Spirit. The gospel lesson from Luke this morning teaches us to never give up in prayer. It was the story of a person bothering his friend in the middle of the night because an unexpected guest was coming through town and he had nothing to feed him. So he went to his friend to borrow some bread. The friend, you know the story, was already in bed and his children were already asleep, so he told the man to go away. Don't bother me, it's too late. And Jesus added, I tell you, even though he won't get up and give him anything because he is his friend, at least because of his persistence, and that word literally means shamelessness, he will get up and give him whatever he needs. Now, God is not really like a friend who has gone asleep and won't do anything unless we bother him enough. The point is, if a flawed human being will rise to the occasion and be generous, because we're persistent or shameless in asking, how much more will God, who is good and cares for the people? And then Jesus added, ask and you will receive. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. This is how we are to pray. Asking, seeking, knocking, and persisting without shame. Do you pray that way? Do you ever feel like you shouldn't bother God? A few years ago, I had a serious bout with cancer, with chemotherapy, radical surgery, the works. My odds were not good. And during that time, I had a hard time praying for myself for healing. My thoughts went like this. How could I bother God when I had already lived longer than most of the people in the rest of the world? Most of them don't get to live till over 65. I had had a good life so far, and my children were doing fine on their own. There were younger people in much worse shape than me. Wouldn't it be selfish for me to ask for life? But my wise husband pointed out to me, he's right there, it's not as though God has a limited amount of spirit or love. God is infinite. If you access God's spirit, you're not taking anything away from anyone else. You're just bringing more spirit, more healing, more love into the world. So we should never be afraid to ask God for anything. We can ask over and over again with passion and without shame. In fact, we should keep asking if it means that much to us. It's not that God requires that we ask a certain number of times. We persist in prayer for our own sake, so that we will stay engaged and connected to God and what is happening around us. We keep praying to discern God's will and be alert to what God is already doing. We don't always get what we ask for in prayer, but we will always get the Holy Spirit, communion with God. And God's Spirit will help us, give us power to get through whatever we need to get through. The Spirit helps us in our weakness. So let us be spiritual and religious. And may the Holy Spirit inspire and energize our practice of religion, that we may shine as lights in the world and bring blessing and life to ourselves and to others. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The next hymn is number 2142, Blessed Quietness. announcements that people want to make before we share joys and concerns? No announcements. Okay, great. What would you like to pray for today? Yes, and I'm telling you, I'm hard of hearing, so please speak up.
Well, I love to share the joy that I really enjoyed your sermon. It was tremendous.
Yes.
Thank you.
It's nice to get that feedback. Thank you. Yes, Kathy.
Yeah, I just had a joy this morning. My son-in-law did the New York City triathlon.
Oh, God.
And it was on this terribly hot day. So they shortened the bike and the run. And he had to swim upstream the Hudson, but the tide was moving that way, so it was with the tide. But you know how they start people, and 5 minutes later they start more, 5 minutes. He was in the back of the pack, and by the time he went, because it was a delay, it was coming back down. So he swam against the current all the way up. It was exhausted, but he had made it, he's done, and I'm thankful for that. But another side note is that Reverend Deborah Gibbon and her husband live in Manhattan. They want to come up the west side. It's closed. So sure he had a very tense ride here. They got here later than they hoped to arrive because of that. And he said, I don't know what happened. They closed the west side.
There you go.
And there's 2,000 bicycles riding around. So I'm sure you
can build weather.
So we thank you for being here and coming through all that and making it much fun.
And what is your son-in-law's name?
James.
James, okay. Other prayer requests? Yes, in the back.
This week, our older daughter, Erica, took and passed the nursing ward. So
yay!
We have a slide also of Judy because her birthday was last week.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
So there's some photos up there. They all paid her a visit. So it's up on the screen right now.
Right. Nice. Thank you for letting me know.
Yeah, happy birthday,
Judy.
Happy birthday, Judy.
Judy Baines, July 17th, Family of Caring, Ridgewood, New Jersey.
Wonderful. I hope you had a joyful day. Any other prayer requests? Yes.
This Wednesday at 9:30 in the morning at the Valley School in Norwood, which is for the autistic children, there will be a dedication of a new swing set in honor of my grandson. And from all the donations and the hard work of my granddaughter in memory of her brother, making bracelets and donating everything, they have enough money plus more to do good things for the children.
Oh, that's great.
What school is that?
The Valley School. Mm-hmm.
Yes?
And
a prayer for Timothy, which is covering from COVID.
Timothy's son?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
And a couple of other members, too, as well.
Yeah.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, it was, I know it was announced to a bunch of people, but I don't know everyone.
Carol and Gary both came down. Well, can you tell me,
can you say something?
Carol and Gary, tested positive for COVID, and they're all in a risk pool in that house, so I think Carol's going to be okay, and Gary went to the hospital to get some, the antiviral infusion on. Eternal God, creator of the world and giver of all good, we acknowledge that we don't know how to pray. May we be open to your spirit, praying through us and lifting us into your presence.
thank you for the earth, our home, and for the gift of life. We praise you for your love shown to us in Jesus Christ, who came to heal this broken world, who died, rejected on the cross, and who rose from the dead in triumph. Because he lives, we live to praise you, our God, forever. We give you thanks this morning for people in our lives who help us to know your love. We thank you for Erica, who passed her nursing boards. We pray your blessing upon her path from now on. We thank you for James, who has successfully swimming against the current. And we pray that you would bless him and give him a rest. We thank you for Judy, who is back among us, and thank you for her life and for those who celebrate her life. And we give you thanks also for the swing sets in the park that are giving life to other children. And merciful God, you bear the pain of the world. Look with compassion on those who are in need in body, mind, or spirit. Especially we remember Timothy, Carol, Gary, and any other members who are suffering from COVID. Bless them, help them to heal quickly. Bless all these people and those we have not named aloud with your healing grace and power. Help us, O God, to be aware of the people around us and to see where we can offer support or help. As we share the suffering of the world, may we also know your joy and power. We pray for the earth, our home, remembering especially those parts of the world that suffer from pollution, intolerable temperatures and fire, floods and storms. Help us as the world community to care for the life of our earth and all the creatures and people in it, especially those who are in harm's way. We remember the people of Ukraine and all places on the earth where there is violence and war. May we seek the ways that lead to peace, that human rights and freedom may be respected and defended, and truth may prevail in our nation and in the nations of the world. By your grace, O Lord, hear our prayers. For you alone we seek. Quiet us in the peace that passes with the peace that passes understanding. And may we shine with the knowledge of your goodness through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
It is now time for the morning offering. May we give generously as God has blessed each one of us.
Sown the seed of our eternal salvation. Through the Holy Spirit, you have planted your word of wisdom and might. We are surrounded by countless acts of your graciousness and are empowered in every way by your sustaining love. Receive the fruits of our labors, which we lay before you, and bless them to your glory. In Christ's name.
Amen.
Closing hymn is number 192, Lord, the light of your love is shining. Love of God.